Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to worship at Northminster Presbyterian Church. We are so glad to be able to come together in this venue that we recognize is not ideal, but provides the most options for all of our members to be able to continue to participate. And for those on the phone, I just want to say thank you for continuing to join us. We recognize that the audio is not always wonderful, and we are doing everything that we can to improve all of these pieces, but we know that there is still an element that is just never going to be the same as worshiping in person. And we're holding all of these things with as much wisdom as we possibly can in figuring out what it means to move forward in this continually challenging time. But I just want to thank you for your patience and for continuing to be with us. I also just want to say that through the course of June, we're going to be looking at different aspects of equity, focusing on racial equity. We did last Sunday, and we will be doing that next Sunday as well. So that is one of the ways that we continue to engage with our culture in this ever-changing and renewing time. That is unsettling also for many different people. So I just want to help you understand that we continue to be a part of that conversation, and we do not see it as a one-time service or a one-time conversation, but that it is something that flows from our continual communal conversation. Now, I want to turn our attention to today, because we have a really special opportunity today. In all of these challenges that have overcome us in these last few months, perhaps one of the things that some of us have lost sight of is how hard it has been for our youth. And so we are going to hear from them today. We're going to hear from those who have a unique perspective, who have had a challenge of overcoming in a unique way. And it is our privilege to be able to stand in the place of learning from these teachers that are in our midst. And before we get started, I know that Zach has just a few announcements.
Hi, everyone. Thanks so much for tuning in. I just have a couple things I wanted to highlight. First is that as we go through our service today, there's going to be a mix of pre-recorded videos and live music. So when those pre-recorded videos come up, I would say just to have your hand near the volume so that you can adjust it as needed, because sometimes the volume can be either too loud or too soft. So if you have the ability to turn up your volume or adjust it, or maybe move your ear away from the phone, I just wanted you to be aware of that. Also, something that I wanted to announce is that we finally have our directory ready to go. So much thanks to Jan and Leslie and Becky and all the people that kind of put their heads together for this to happen. So if you would like a copy of that, I do have a list of people who have already asked. And also just wanted to let you know that you can email me at zach.calvo@northminsterprez.org if you want to be on that list, and I will get that going on Monday. So that is all of the announcements that I have for today. So let us quiet our hearts and come to God in worship. Thank you.
join me in the call to worship? O God, who has always existed in the tension, we come to worship holding beauty in pain. Help us to find our center through the assurance of your love. We exist in a moment where we struggle to know what the right things are. Help us to use this time to discern who we are becoming. We live in a world that cries out for justice and restoration. Help us to find our inner peace so that we can respond in bravery. As we ask ourselves what we can do, help us to continually ask for change in ourselves, our city, our country, and our world.
Life flows on in endless song, above earth's lamentation. I hear the clear, though far off hymn that hails a new creation. No storm can shake my inmost calm, while to that rock I'm clinging. Since Christ is Lord of heaven and earth, how can I keep from singing through all the turmoil and the strife? I hear that music ringing, it finds an
This is a poem I wrote about police brutality that's happening, and it's called Dear Child. Don't worry, child, everything will be okay. One day you'll be able to walk in a grocery store without looking suspicious. One day our sisters, and most importantly our brothers, will be able to go on a jog without being afraid of getting tracked down and shot. The world is changing, child. It's changing fast. We're going to need more than just evidence and facts to help us. We're going to need to be stronger, child. We will walk down these streets and protest until we are free. It might take a while, but I believe we will get there. The ignorant white folks need to care. Once we have them on our side, everything might be all right. But until then, we will strike from dusk till dawn until we seek justice and breathe equality in our community. Don't cry, child. I'll try to protect you from these horrific stories and, most importantly, the truth. The truth is very scary, dear, but one day you'll grow up and you'll see it's not pretty and that we have to keep fighting, and maybe when you're older, you'll become a leader. You'll protest in this unfair world and you'll try to make it fair. You'll start a new movement, a new awakening. You might even bring us a new sense of peace. And maybe that, my child, is what we need. Sleep tight, dream great dreams. You are loved by me.
So I would invite us just to take a few moments of silence to sort of sit with that. So let's take that moment now. Loving God, help us to listen, to sit with this moment, knowing that you love and care for us even in the midst of beauty and pain. Friends, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Now let us sing the Gloria together. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be. World without end. Amen. Amen.
Gracious God, as we receive and reflect on your word, remind us that your voice comes to us in many ways and through many perspectives. Amen.
I love the Lord because he has heard my voice and my supplications, because he inclined his ear to me. Therefore, I will call on him as long as I live. What shall I return to the Lord for all his bounty to me? I will lift up the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. Precious in the sight of the Lord, in his death and his faithful ones. O Lord, I am your servant. I am your servant, the child of your servant girl. You have loosened my bond. I will offer to you a thanksgiving sacrifice, and I call on the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. In the courts of the house, the Lord in your midst, O Jerusalem, praise the Lord, the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
This is a song about being brave and telling the truth. You can be amazing, you can turn a phrase into a weapon or a drug. You can be the outcast or be the backlash of somebody's lack of love. Or you can start speaking up. Nothing's gonna hurt you the way the words do when they settle beneath your skin. Kept on the inside in no sunlight, sometimes a shadow wins. But I wonder what would happen if you say what you wanna say and let the words fall out. Honestly, I wanna see you be brave with what you wanna say and let the words fall out. Honestly, I wanna see you be brave. Just wanna see you. I just wanna see you. I wanna see you. I wanna see you be brave. Just wanna see you. I just wanna see you. I wanna see you. I wanna see you be brave. Everybody's been there, everybody's been stared down by the enemy. Fallen for the fear and done some disappearing. Bow down to the mighty. Don't run. Stop holding your tongue. Maybe there's a way out of the cage where you live. Maybe one of these days you can let the light in. Show me how big your brave is. Say what you wanna say and let the words fall out. Honestly, I wanna see you be brave. And since your history of silence won't do you any good, did you think you would? Let your words be anything but empty. Why don't you tell them the truth? Say what you wanna say and let the words fall out. Honestly, I wanna see you be brave with what you wanna say and let the words fall out. Honestly, I wanna see you be brave. I wanna see you be brave. Oh, see you be brave.
Hi, everyone. I'm Delaney Hammer, and I hope you all are doing well. In light of everything that's happening right now, I thought I'd like to share a video by kindergarten teacher Vera Ejia that explains the basics of current events that are happening with the Black Lives Matter movement right now. Church teaches us that it is important to love one's neighbor as one loves themselves, and it is very important to remember this teaching right now. And during this video, I'd like you to think about how the video makes you feel.
Hello, my name is Miss Ejia, and I wanted to talk to you today about all of the things that are going on right now. You may have noticed or heard your family talk about what's happening in the news. Beyond just the COVID virus, which is spreading, we also are combating a different kind of disease. This is not the disease that you catch from germs from person to person, but it's something that happens with the way that people think. And some people have the belief that people with black or brown skin should not have the same rights or privileges as people with white skin. This is called racism, and racism has happened in the United States for over 400 years. That's a very long time. And by now you would think that something so terrible would be gone. But it's not that easy. Racism is everywhere. And it is our job to stop it. One way to stop racism is to call it out when you see it. That means if you see someone being treated differently because of the color of their skin, you have the voice, you make the choice to say, this is wrong. If you see someone being treated differently because of the color of their skin, you have a choice. You can decide to say something or walk away. But your choice can impact the lives of a lot of people. So right now, what's happening is a lot of people are making the choice to say, that's wrong. Racism is wrong. And they are talking specifically about racism towards Black people. Black people typically have skin color similar to mine. Black people have been in the United States for a very long time. Black people have been fighting against slavery or fighting against racism for a very long time. As long as those 400 years, they have been fighting for things to be better. You may have heard a very important.
Okay. So obviously there's more to that video that you can find on YouTube if you want to watch more of it. But now it's time for us to pray. Dear God, help us to have the ability to love our neighbors and help us do the work we need to do so that everyone can have equal opportunities. Amen.
The second lesson comes from Matthew chapter 9. Then Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and every sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." Then Jesus summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits, to cast them out and to cure every disease and every sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, also known as Peter, and his brother Andrew. James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John. Philip and Bartholomew. Thomas and Matthew the tax collector. James, son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus. Simon the Canaanite. And Judas Iscariot, the one who betrayed him.
These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions. Go nowhere among the Gentiles and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As you go, proclaim the good news. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. You receive without payment, give without payment, take no gold or silver or copper in your belts. No bag for the journey, or two tunics, or sandals, or a staff, for laborers deserve their food. Whatever town or village you enter, find out who in it is worthy, and stay there until you leave. As you enter the house, greet it. If the house is worthy, let your peace come upon it. If it is not worthy, let your peace return to you. If anyone will not welcome you or listen to your words, shake off the dust from your feet as you leave that house or town. Truly, I tell you, it will be more tolerable for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah on the day of judgment than for that town. See, I am sending you out like sheep into the midst of wolves. So be wise as serpents and innocent as doves. Beware of them, for they will hand over to the councils and flog you in their synagogues. You will be dragged before governors and kings because of me, as a testimony to them and the Gentiles. When they hand you over,
Do not worry about how you are to speak or what you are to say, for what you are to say will be given to you at that time. For it is not who you speak, but the spirit of your Father speaking through you. Brother will betray brother to death, and father is his child. And children will rise against parents and have them put to death. And you will be hated by all because of my name. But the one who endures to the end will be saved. When they persecute you in one town, flee to the next. For truly I tell you, you will not have gone through towns all over Israel before the Son of Man comes. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thanks, Seth and Timo. And for everyone that has participated so far, I just, as I sit and listen and absorb all of this, I'm just reminded of how much truth and how much perspective that we gain when we listen to all the voices in our community. And today is a day where we do that with youth, and also recognize that that is something that we value more than just one Sunday, but something that we really hope to continue to value and put sort of concrete things around as we continue to support our youth. So today, I wanted to have a sort of a conversation or hear from two of our graduating seniors. And I think Danny named it really well in the beginning of the service that this has been a really hard time and a really complicated time for all of us. And I think I'm especially aware of that as we are in graduation season, and graduation looks significantly different than I think a lot of us, probably all of us, pictured. And so we're just gonna spend some time hearing from Annika Carlson and Annie Voiles about how that has impacted them and how that impacts the way that they see the world. So we're just gonna spend some time in reflection with them. And I think I want to start with Andy. And Andy, if you could just tell us first, before you share your reflection, sort of where you're at right now and what your plans are for college and for the future.
So yeah, I just finished my senior year. Our virtual graduation is on Tuesday. And in August, I'm going to start going to school at Montana State University out in Bozeman.
Awesome. That's really exciting. So I know that you've prepared some reflections, so I'd love to be able to hear what those are at this time.
Yeah. So this pandemic has been extremely difficult for all of us. Beyond the obvious tragedy of hundreds of thousands of people dying and millions of people losing their livelihoods, we are all experiencing much smaller struggles, not being able to hug family members or go to church, just to name a few. It's also really hard to reconcile how our faith fits within this mess. We know that faith makes it better, and we know that God does hear all of our prayers, and there is a certain comfort that comes with believing. And at the same time, it's very hard seeing many people that share our faith telling their congregants not to listen to science, and that if their faith is strong enough, you will not succumb to this disease. And this is especially hard when it comes from a pastor or priest because of the inherent authority structure that is at play. And in an op-ed, the rabbi Irving Greenberg recently pointed out in the Wall Street Journal that these voices aren't promoting faith, but rather magic, which is biblically abhorrent. And he goes on to reinforce that the age of miracles has passed, and God has made a conscious decision not to exercise the full extent of his strength. And at first glance, this is a daunting reality to face, because hearing this may cause some of us to wonder how much God is really with us. But on the contrary, this shouldn't be scary. It should motivate us. Knowing that God loves us and wants us to forge our own paths should be extremely motivating, because it means that we have agency. It means that working for progress has actual weight. And it means that though our religion is centered around events that happened thousands of years ago, we can still use the Bible and values that God has given us to continue to shape how we live our lives. Our Christian faith has been shaped greatly by disease over the past 2,000 years, and we have made the world a better place through the innovation that has come out of these otherwise awful times. Frank Snowden, a professor in the history of medicine at Yale, says, "Epidemics are a category of disease that seem to hold up the mirror to human beings as to who we really are. That is to say, they obviously have everything to do with our relationship to mortality, to death, to our lives." This is strikingly similar to why our religion is so important to each of us. In our faith, two of the most important dates are the birth of Jesus and his death. So naturally, epidemics cause a lot of people to focus on religion and vice versa. This can be seen looking at especially Western Europe, specifically Italy, from, depending on who you ask, between about 1347, when the Black Death first arrived, until around 1743, when it left. In Venice, for example, you'll see the Church of St. Hulk, the patron saint of plague, that was built in the late 1400s. At the top of the Castel Sant'Angelo, there's a statue of the archangel sheathing his sword to show that God is no longer angry with the Romans after the Black Death. This period led us to value the saints of illness more, again, St. Hulk, but also St. Sebastian, the patron saint of martyrs. Our modern medical system also comes out of this time. If a 16th century Venetian were to come to New York or San Francisco and go to a hospital there, they'd see a lot of similarities. What we now think of as PPE, or personal protective equipment, also came out of this time of relentless plague. Doctors would wear masks with what looked like long beaks to try to protect them, and they'd also wear a sort of waxy clothing, which they thought would capture particles of disease and keep them from getting sick. And in fact, responses to the outbreaks of diseases like cholera and the techniques that were used to combat its spread have saved millions of lives over the centuries since they were first developed. And similarly to today, this was the beginning of a period of immense personal and societal introspection. Individuals began to think more critically about how the actions they took in this life would affect them in the next life, and the lives of commoners started to become valued more than they previously had been, albeit not as much as they should have been. So we see that it's impossible to talk about the emergence of the early modern era without talking about disease, because on a larger scale, when people began thinking about their lives and the significance that they have, they began to question larger power structures around them. They saw that priests were human, they could die from disease as well, and that priests shouldn't have as much influence as they previously had. This helps people become more aware of corruption and maladministration within the church, and in many ways helped accelerate the path to the Reformation and an embrace of Enlightenment ideals, one of which being that faith and science aren't at odds. They work in tandem with each other to help us further enjoy this world that God has given to us. So, applying this knowledge to the fight for equality we have today should serve as a reminder that great struggles to bring us closer to equality have happened before. And if we do the hard work of listening and using our voices to elevate those who don't have one, we truly can bring about the change that is wanted and needed, because God has provided the handbook for us to love all of each other and to fight for those who are forced to live on their knees while we live on our feet.
Well, thanks, Andy, for bringing in some church history and your own perspective and tying it to our moment. I think as Annika and Andy and I talked this week, and I got to sort of hear where they were coming from, what they were writing about and thinking about, I realized how much connection there was with what they're both saying. So before I ask Andy some questions, I'm actually going to turn it over to Annika, because I think there are a lot of connections between what Andy is talking about and what Annika has prepared for us today. So Before I move to Annika, I do want to just offer a moment again of sort of silence. I think that there's a lot of talking that we do in our worship services, and I just, Andy just said a lot, and I think there was a lot in there. So let's just spend a couple seconds in silence, and then I'm going to hand it over to Annika to tell us a little bit about where she's headed and then have her share her thoughts. So let's engage in this moment of silence together in response to Andy. All right, Annika, go for it.
Hi, you all know me, I'm Annika. Next year I'm planning on attending North Seattle College, which is near my house through the Seattle Promise program that the city has gratefully offered me. And hopefully after that, I will transfer to Western Washington University and study psychology. But yeah, this is what I had to say and some of my thoughts that I had over this whole experience. So needless to say, this is certainly not what I thought the end of my senior year would be like. And when I knew that I wouldn't get to have that experience, I was kind of heartbroken. I wanted so badly to say goodbye to my friends and go to prom and watch my family cry as I accepted the diploma that I've worked so hard for the past 13 years of my life. But I don't get to do that, and I never will. And knowing that, it made me angry, and it made me cry alone in the middle of the night, and it made me bitter towards people who didn't understand. I'm not very proud of these feelings, but I can't deny their existence. After a while of grieving, I started to hate that I was feeling this way. I thought, how dare I be so upset when people are dying and starving and suffering? I don't get to go to prom? Well, some people don't get to eat today. And I also realized that it wasn't just me who was suffering. It was my entire class and the entire world. Some people are more upset than others, but I wasn't alone in my feelings. This caused me to not only dislike myself for feeling the emotions that I was feeling, but I also began to push them away and pretend that they didn't exist. Now, as we all know, pushing down your feelings will always make things worse. The days went by and I just felt sadder and sadder. And I could still laugh and I could still genuinely smile. And there were moments when I forgot about the pain entirely. But once that moment was gone, it was back to feeling depressed and exhausted. I just felt so heavy all the time. And since I was embarrassed, I also didn't tell anyone. So that made me feel incredibly lonely. And it was around this time that I began to distract myself with Instagram and the news, and so I began to pay attention more to the world outside of my own house. And this is when I saw society right now for what it truly is, and that is racism and sexism, classism, climate issues, and government oppression, all of which I knew it existed, but I had never paid so much attention to before. Many people hadn't. So like the rest of my generation, I was outraged, and I decided that I needed to do what I could to change it. And it's honestly been really inspiring for the past few weeks. While in this time, it can feel like the world is ending, and it has also been a wake-up call for the privileged. People are finally feeling the motivation to demand change and to challenge issues and also learn about themselves. But this time is painful, and it can seem really unbearable at times, and I myself can't wait for it to be over. But this time is also where so much change is happening. A revolution is upon us, and we are given this experience, and it's pushing us to take anyways. And it got to a point where I couldn't really ignore it anymore, and I faced it. and I began to think about God. And I started to wonder if there was really someone up there, and if there was, what were they thinking about me right now? Started asking questions, what should I do? Am I weak? Am I being selfish? How do I stop feeling this way? When will we move past this, and when will the world get better? Thoughts have begun to enter my head since then that I hadn't really accepted before. This time is painful, and everyone is feeling lost right now. And it's a lot to expect from a person to just power through it and not feel anything. But I've already lived through some pretty bad things so far, and I'm still here. And it isn't as bad as I thought it was going to be. And I'm honestly stronger than I was before because of it. I must acknowledge this pain, but I also acknowledge that there is good happening right now. Yeah, I lost my senior year, but the environment is having a break from the level of pollution it was facing, and people are standing up and not accepting the hatred and oppression anymore. Almost the entire world right now is demanding justice, and I also get to spend more time with my family, which I don't know when I'll get to spend this much time with them ever again. So that's been really lovely. And I've also been given a lot of time to reflect on who I am and how to cope with things, which I also haven't gotten to do to this extent before. After this, I believe I will be braver, better, and stronger as a person. And there will always be something in life that is hard. The work for a better life is far from over. But I hope that things will get better as time goes by. And that's honestly what keeps you moving. That hope is what makes it bearable. In the scripture that we recently read, it said that the disciples are going to have to endure a lot. Jesus says that it will be painful and full of conflict. But he also says to trust that things will get better and that if you stay standing, you'll be saved. I've realized that God isn't here to make life perfect. God is here to help us guide through life when it isn't. And I'd like to think that that's what the seniors are being told right now during this crisis. We are enduring a lot of pain and we are very scared. And sometimes we feel like nothing is worth it and the entire world is going to end. But I think God has a different plan for us, a plan that makes us the voice of change. We are going to be entering the world and be a generation that is really strong, and we are brave, and we will be the cause of change and start the revolution that will make this world a better place than it was before. I'm so proud to be in the class of 2020, and I'm so excited for what we are going to do. Thank you.
Thank you, Annika. Just to honor your words, again, I'm just going to ask for a few moments of silence to kind of absorb what we heard and to kind of breathe it in. So let's take those few moments of silence. So I am really moved by both of you and your words today and your willingness to share them. I think that's a really vulnerable thing that we don't talk about a lot, is how hard it can be to share where we are. And something that I noticed in the two of you in different ways that I think is really commendable and something that I want to name is that you both, in your own way, kind of start looking inward and dealing with the pain of the moment, right? Andy started by talking about not being able to hug your family or thinking about what it means to not be at church, like this sort of the inner turmoil that we all experience, right? And Annika, you spent time talking about your own inner process and how painful that's been. And I think one of the most important things for us as we are in this world that we are in right now is to be able to turn inside and try to figure out what's in there, and not be afraid of it and not shame ourselves for it. So I see that you guys really do that in your words. And then I also see that you also have a way of then, after engaging your own inner self, kind of turning outward. Andy, that's thinking through history and what history means for us now. Annika, that has meant your own sort of personal reflection on how you see the world in a new way. And so I guess I'm just wondering, do you two have just any more thoughts about how you deal with yourself and are honest with yourself about your own feelings and emotions that would be helpful for us? I know we talked about that a little bit this week, so I'm wondering if you could just, maybe we'll start with Annika. I just would ask you, what would you say to us to help us through the process that you are going through?
Well, for me, a lot of it has just been really allowing yourself to feel what you're feeling and giving yourself permission to react in a way that may not seem right, but still accept that that's what's going on in your head and think about why you're feeling that way, and also try to focus on what else is happening that you may not be focusing so much on. Like for me, for a while, I was just focusing so much on the negative, but then I began to sort of think more like, what is happening right now that's positive, and what is something that I could look forward to that can help me move forward, not only in my journey with myself, but my journey with God and the world, and yeah, sort of just that idea of giving yourself permission to feel.
Thank you. I think that's a reminder that we need every day. For me, probably every hour. Andy, what would your response be to that? What would you say to us?
Building off of what Annika said, just focusing on the positive. For all the struggles that the world has, the world is still a good place. People are made in God's image, so humans are still inherently good. And so for all the struggles that happen, our focus, I think, at least for me, needs to be on lifting other people up, because a rising tide lifts all boats. And I think that that's the only way forward, because it's cliche, but we're all on the same side. We're all in this together. We're all we've got. So we got to treat each other like teammates. We have to show genuine compassion and love towards each other in every facet of life. And so just being as positive as possible, despite everything that's going on.
Yeah. Thank you both so much for your willingness to share. I have one last question before we start moving on. Maybe Andy, you can answer this one first. I'm just wondering, in this next season of your life, what do you feel called to do? Who do you feel called to be? Or, you know, what will you take with you from this season into your next, the next season of your life that has a lot of change in it? What do you want to take?
Especially with these protests, I think that I, as well as probably every other white person here, has realized that we know that we've had privilege, but we don't quite know the extent to which we've had privilege. And so that's helped me appreciate what I have even more. And so going forward, as I enter my college life, I want to spend more time volunteering with different groups of people. I've always enjoyed working at the Boys and Girls Club and working with kids that are younger, because I think that provides a very positive experience for them. So I'm hoping out in Montana to do more of that, to educate myself more when it comes to issues like racism. Ask people that experience racism on a daily basis what I can do, so that I'm listening and not speaking over them.
That feels so real. I think we all need to learn that lesson. Annika, how would you respond? Well, what do you want to take with you?
Well, similarly to what Andy was saying, just really learning to listen to others, because just for so long, I have not really bothered to educate myself on a lot of things, even though I've cared about certain issues, I just haven't taken the time that I should have. And so really taking time to listen to others and educate myself on what it's like to live in a different body and be in a different culture and suffer from different things. That way I could be more empathetic towards others and know more on how to change the world for the better, as well as just standing up for what I believe in and not being afraid anymore. Because I think what these recent developments and protests have shown is just how much power we all have, and the fact that standing up for what you believe in is not as scary, I guess, as we, at least as I thought it would be. And I think for a lot of people, while it's still very scary, I think this whole experience that we're all going through has given us this newfound strength to do what we think is right and just start changing the world.
Well, thank you both for being willing to share. I think that we could have a moment of sort of silently applauding you, because I know that this has been both a hard time and a time of deep introspection for both of you. And I'm just so happy to hear these things, because they are a benefit to all of us, not just on one Sunday, but your presence in all times. So with that, let's go to prayer together. Gracious God, thank you that you ask us to turn inward and to do internal work, to know who we are and know who we are in relationship to other people and to you. We thank you that you don't ask us to stop there, but you also ask us to turn outward, to ask what we can do, who we can be in the midst of a world that has a lot of complicated choices that it presents to us. So thank you for the perspective of all our youth. Help us to continue to listen to a myriad of different voices and perspectives as we move forward into the future and to who we are becoming. In your name, amen. Next, we're going to turn to a hymn for everyone born.
For everyone born, a place at the table. For everyone born, clean water and bread. Shelter, a space, a safe place for growth. Delight when we justice and joy. For everyone born, a place at the table, to live without fear and simply to be.
To just turn your attention to our order of worship. If you are wanting to give in this time, there are some links there that you can follow and some information about how to do that. And so bless you in however you choose to give in this time, whether that be through gifts or your time or any of those things. So next we have an offertory from Karina Hammer, which she has graciously recorded for us. So I'm going to go back to my screen share mode, and we are going to hear Mists of Mount Rainier. Also wanted to just make note of a thank you to St. Andrew's Presbyterian Church, who allowed me to come in and record some music for the hymns this morning. So, all right, here we go. All right, I'm having some technical difficulty, so just give me two more seconds and I got it. Thank you, Karina. Let's join in the doxology together. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all creatures here below. Praise God above, ye heavenly hosts. Creator, Savior, Holy Ghost. Amen.
On this Sunday, where we pause and recognize the challenges of our younger generation, we ask for the wisdom of how to offer support and love. In your mercy, Lord, hear our prayer. We are overwhelmed with the world's need for prayer and healing. For India, where the numbers of the virus rise. For South America, and especially those that are far from the resources of the city. Today we pray for the younger generation, as so much that they did not create is landing on them. We pray for young leaders to rise up. We pray that as a culture, we would be open to listen. In your mercy, Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for our country, and we ask for compassion, wisdom, and guidance. Teach us to become people who can point in the direction of healing. We pray especially for the young people among us. We pray for those that are graduating this year from high school and universities. We pray for stamina and safety. We ask for bravery and imagination and peace. In your mercy, Lord, hear our prayer. We pray especially this morning for Annika and Andy. As this generation has had to face a hardship that the rest of us can only imagine, we pray for grace and resilience. We ask that you would guide their path as they make their way into the future. We commit them to you and continue to lift them up to you. In your mercy, Lord, hear our prayer. For the next part of our prayer, please offer your specific prayer request in the chat. If you are on the phone, please speak your prayer requests, knowing that God can hear you, even though we cannot. For the places where the virus is spreading, Lord, hear our prayer. For continuing healing for Liz's niece, Johanna, Lord, hear our prayer. For Suzuyu's family in Taiwan, Lord, hear our prayer. A prayer of thanks for our youth, Lord, hear our prayer. And for all our youth, especially our youth of color, Lord, hear our prayer. For Dana's Aunt Janice, who is undergoing chemotherapy for breast cancer, Lord, hear our prayer. Now we join our voices together across the city and even farther to pray the prayer that you taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
We are now going to turn to our next hymn, and thank you so much for walking the technology tightrope today. Thank you.
Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. You are speaking truth to power. You are laying down our swords, replanting every vineyard till a brand new wine is poured. Your peace will make us one. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Your peace will make us one. Feeding in the wee hours of the night. Your gentle love is patient. You will never fade or tire. Your peace will make us one. Glory, glory, hallelujah.
Friends, so after we have our benediction this morning, we are going to have a postlude with Akilah, so hang tight for that. But before we head out, our charge this week is going to be from Miss Amp.
Your charge this week is to get out there and to remember to be brave.
Good words. May the God of all creation bless you and keep you. May Jesus Christ make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And may the Holy Spirit lift up her countenance upon you and give you peace. And all of God's children said, Amen. Thank you.
Yeah.